evening. I'm Nisa Sorolnik.
I'm Jay Kaplan.
I'm Steve Ferguson.
And I'm Sean Roman.
And this is On the Sports Lines for February 11th, 2010. The Winter Olympics begin tomorrow in Vancouver. We'll take a look at the people, events, and storylines worth watching. We'll also give you some final thoughts on Super Bowl 44, our NBA midseason report, and a look at NASCAR's Super Bowl, the Daytona 500. As always, we want to hear from you, so send your emails to fanspeak@onthesportslines.com. We just may read yours on the show. After spending many of their 43 years as NFL doormats, the New Orleans Saints are finally Super Bowl champs, beating the Indianapolis Colts 31-17 behind game MVP Drew Brees. Sean, final thoughts on Super Bowl 44?
I think it was 2 weeks ago I said the Bucks were the team of the decade.
Yeah, and I told you you were crazy.
A perennial Absolutely. Bottom feeder had won it all. All right, I amend that. Now we have some co-champions,
there you go.
The Saints and the Bucks. The turning point of the game for me was the interception, Tracy Porter.
Yeah.
He read the play right, and what was could have been a tie game was a 14-point turnaround.
Mm-hmm.
At that point, pretty much it was time to turn off the Super Bowl and turn on Animal Planet's Puppy Bowl.
Oh, my God.
You want to give us a that, Puppy Bowl report?
The Puppy Bowl, in my humble opinion, is the greatest spinoff in TV history.
Yeah.
The geniuses who came up with this should be hired by NBC to turn around their problematic late-night situation.
Man.
The concept is so simple. Decorate some kind of field to look like a football field, get a bunch of puppies, put them in the field, and let them play, and that's it.
You know, Sean, if we can actually get back to human football for a second. You talk about Tracy Porter reading that play. And on Indianapolis' second possession of the game, the New Orleans Saints switched defenses from their standard 3-4 to a 3-3-5. They replaced a linebacker with a cornerback. And the coverages and blitzes that came out of that package ultimately confused and flummoxed Peyton Manning into making some mistakes that ultimately led to that interception.
Yeah, it's so rare to confuse him.
He seems
to know
true.
Almost everything that's going on in the field. Well, for me, and I can't top the Puppy Bowl, I don't think anybody
can.
Yeah, exactly. I would tell you that it's about time New Orleans has a winner. 43 years this franchise has waited for something positive to happen. You got to remember, this team has only made the playoffs two other times. That was in the 80s. Mm-hmm. That's the days of Jim Mora. And so what Sean Payton has done with this team in 4 years is nothing short of a miracle. And the other thing I want to tell you guys is, for those of you who think Drew Brees is not an NFL quarterback who belongs in the top three, think again. He had a fantastic game, and he was much better than Peyton Manning. First quarter, 3-for-7. After that, the guy was amazing.
Steve, you mentioned Sean Payton. I think his call of the game was in the second half.
And oh, my God. That was
unbelievable. Every looked up, there was an onside kick.
Yeah.
It shocked everybody.
Yeah, I tell you, you talk about Brees. Tied Tom Brady's Super Bowl 38 record for most completions by a quarterback, 32. He was, like you said, slow start. He was 29 of his last 32, his last 10 in a row. He basically took what Indy's cover two defense gave him, which was the underneath routes, and he just walked him down the field. I mean, Peyton didn't have a bad game, but that one interception was the complete turning point. Between the two of them, they did tie a Super Bowl record for most completions by a quarterback, by both quarterbacks in the same game. And, you know, here's something else that came out of that Super Bowl. Reggie Bush now joins a very elite club. He is now one of three running backs, Tony Dorsett and Marcus Allen are the others, who have won a Heisman, a national championship in college, and a Super Bowl.
Wow.
That's amazing.
I didn't realize there were so few.
I didn't either.
But you know what, guys, what struck me, though, is Coach Jim Caldwell's way too conservative
play calling.
Mm-hmm. Yes.
What was up with that? Running the ball right before halftime with like a minute left when they needed to score, and then again at the end of the fourth quarter, running when they should have been throwing. That was very puzzling. That was a big thing.
I think he was afraid to make mistakes, to be honest with you. And I think when you have a guy like Peyton Manning, who's such a great quarterback, you kind of let him run the show, and I think that's what he did.
You got to take a few risks.
I agree.
Don't forget that the Colts jumped out to a very big lead, 10 points. And that's the highest margin from which a team has ever
that's
come
true.
Back.
In a Super Bowl, but you know, in the NFL, that's not that big of a lead.
Right.
No.
In general.
Mm-hmm.
Well, moving on, guys. The Winter Olympics in Vancouver begin tomorrow night, and the big storyline is the chance for Canada to take gold in its national sport. Steve, gold may be a bit of a reach, but do the U.S. men have a chance to medal at all?
Well, Nisa, if they have any chance, I'm thinking bronze, because then they have definitely some good elements. I mean, you can start with the goaltenders.
Yeah.
Ryan Miller of the Sabres is an outstanding goaltender. Tim Thomas won the Vezina Trophy. These are great goaltenders.
Yeah.
The team offensively, unfortunately, doesn't have Mike McDonald, because if they did, that would give them a real good possibility of getting at least bronze. But they do have Zach Parise, Phil Kessel, and Bobby Ryan. These are all young guys under 25. They're very talented. And they're led by Rafalski, who is an outstanding defenseman. We all know him from the Devils' days. Mm-hmm. So do they have a chance? Yeah, at possibly the bronze. That's about as far as I would go.
You know, I think the most favorable way to look at this is there are 12 teams, hockey teams, that are in it, and yep. 8 move on to the knockout round. So right now the U.S. has a 66% chance of getting into the knockout rounds.
Oh, man.
But I think all the spots are just taken by more talented teams. Yeah. Last time in the Olympics, it was Sweden against Finland, and Sweden won the gold, and they have a 1,000-year winter sports rivalry. And I think they're both going to be there. Canada's going to have that extra incentive to do well in front of the home crowd, and Russia has the best scores of any team. I think those are the four that make up your final four in hockey.
I got to agree with you, Sean, on that. Steve, I agree with you. I don't think the U.S. men will medal. I don't even think they have a chance at bronze.
Well,
I think the U.S. women actually have a better chance to medal.
Yeah, they probably do.
They will, in my mind, they will wind up playing Canada for the gold, and it kind of makes sense, because ever since women's hockey became an Olympic sport in 1998, Canada's won 2 of the 3 goals.
Yeah.
The U.S. has the other.
Wow.
As for the gold medal game, Sean, I'm going with Canada and Russia, because I think that's the matchup everybody wants to see. Why?
Yeah.
Sidney Crosby.
Yep.
Alex Ovechkin. Head-to-head together again. And as everybody knows who pays attention to the NHL, these are the two best players in the league, and they don't much like each other. Forget the fact that their teams are arch rivals. These two guys don't much like each other. Should make for some interesting on-ice drama.
Definitely be interesting. With men's, women's, pairs, and ice dancing, figure skating figures to get plenty of airtime. Jay, what are the medal chances for the U.S. here?
Depends on which discipline you're looking at. The U.S. men with Evan Lysacek, Johnny Weir, and Jeremy Abbott have a chance to medal. I won't go as far as to say gold. The U.S. women, not so much. Rachel Flatt is the world champ, but she's way too young and inexperienced. She's no Sasha Cohen. The U.S., you know, their medal hopes took a hit when she did not make the squad.
Absolutely.
As far as the pairs go, Steve and I, we talked about this. Yep. I mean, you'll give the names in a second, but I mean, who?
Yeah, exactly.
Ice dancing is their best shot. Belbin and Augusto are the reigning silver medalists. Mm-hmm. And the team that beat them in the U.S. world, U.S. Nationals, Davis and White. So they both have a chance to medal, but you know what? In ice dancing, the Russians have won every gold since 1964.
Amazing.
So who knows?
Well, as you said, Lysacek is definitely the guy for the U.S., and he has the best chance. But the one guy you have to watch is that guy, Patrick Chan of Canada. He is really good, and he's going to be in front of his home crowd, and this is a guy who will challenge him for the gold, most likely. Now, of course, in the pairs side, you're looking at Belbin and Augusto, and these they are just terrific. They have won more championships in their sport than any other U.S. team, so they have a real good chance of at least medaling, I'd say, gold or at least silver.
Guys, what's your tolerance for listening to Scott Hamilton broadcast sports? Is it once every 4 years or around
That's
that?
About as long Something as like I can that. Take it. And, you know, it starts to shrink from the time he starts talking until the Olympics
end. You know, like you guys said, I think Evan's got the greatest chance for men's gold of any of the figure skaters. However, on the women's side, although there isn't a real U.S. competitor in the mix, there is a Japanese competitor who is so famous in Japan, Miki Ando, that she would have the paparazzi over there camp out in front of her house, and she couldn't get any training done. So in 2007, they sent her over to Connecticut, and she's living basically a hermitic existence over there. She can't drive. Toyota sponsors her. They won't let her drive under that sponsorship contract. Nobody knows who she is. She could live a great Northeast Coastern life, and she's been focused in training while some of the other, and New York Times just did an article on this, some of the other Asian competitors that are propelling to prominence because of their diet, their weight, their ability to jump very high and do these spins and the more modern look at ladies figure skating, have not had that level of concentration. So take a look at Miki Ando as the winner of the, as possibly the winner as the women's figure skating event.
Interesting. Yeah. Well, while hockey and skating are major storylines, there are plenty of others to be found. Sean, what Olympian or Olympic event are you going to be following?
Well, part of the fun of the Olympics is there are all sorts of wacky combined events. And believe it or not, the U.S. has never got a medal in two of those very prominent winter sports events. One is the biathlon, where cross-country skiers go crazy, and then they got to control their heart rate, take aim, and just shoot at very small targets. And the other is the men's Nordic combined, where there's ski jumping along with cross country skiing.
Right.
So I'm looking for I'm looking for medals for the U.S. In especially the men's Nordic combined. The athlete that I'm going to be paying most attention to is Bodie Miller. This guy. I mean, you guys go
party boy.
Yeah, the party boy. I was thinking the same thing.
Believe it or not, his comment was to the AP like, listen. I had a great Olympic experience hanging out and socializing or something like that. There's a lot of substance to what this guy says. Huh. He is a guy who doesn't let the media get to him. He really doesn't care what they think of him. If you ask people who are really skiing, they're like, there is no guy who's a better competitor. And I think he gets the value that most people don't get, that medals and awards, they're just trinkets. What's important in life are the great experiences you have along the way. And Bodie Miller, over the last 8 years, has had more great ski experiences than anybody else on the entire ski tour.
Yeah, well, he lives life
very well.
You
know how this guy's training right now? He's running up a mountain with a woman in a wheelbarrow.
Wow. Really?
Yeah, that's one of his training exercises.
Oh, he's unique, like, to say the least.
Well, once again, I can't top what you said, Sean. But who I'm looking at is Gretchen Bleiler. She is, first of all, she's one of the best, if not the best, women snowboarder. This woman has won almost every award you can win. She's a four-time X Games champ. She's won numerous half-pipe medals. She's also one of the hottest-looking women on the planet.
Ho!
And she's also huge in the fashion design industry. Ask the people at Oakley, because she has a collection with them. So, yeah, I think she has a great chance of winning this thing. And, you know, the only other one she has to worry about is Tedder, which is a competitor on the USA team.
Well, Steve, I'll top you in terms of good-looking, you know, U.S. women female athletes. Lindsey Vonn, who is the most decorated skier in U.S. history, two-time defending World Cup champ. She has won every downhill race except one this season. And though she's known for more as much for spectacular crashes and making Sports Illustrated swimsuit issues, than she, as almost as she is for wins. I mean, her last crash was right before the 2006 Games. She had a shin injury on February 1. She has said today that her pain is down from debilitated to something she feels she can grit her teeth through.
Wow.
She won't know the full extent of the injury until she hits the downhill course tomorrow. But her first race is not until Sunday. As long as she at least starts one of the three training races, she will qualify. The other guy I want to keep an eye on is Shani Davis, the U.S. speed skater. Mm. He's competing in 500, 1,000, 1,500, and 5,000. That's the four major races. And the thing about this guy is he's an enigma wrapped up inside a puzzle. Ever since his feud with both the press and his teammates at the 2006 Games, he has kind of with the team, but on his own. He does everything on his own. No coach, no help, no nothing.
Wow.
So it'll be interesting. He has a great chance to medal in each of those. But every time he steps out on the ice, he basically steps out alone. So he will be interesting
that
to watch.
Unique.
Well, guys, don't forget about Sean White, the U.S. snowboarder.
Oh, yeah.
He won the gold in the last Winter Olympics. He's determined to repeat. And this is a guy who, in the X Games, he smacked his face against the halfpipe during practice, and he still won the event. So, I mean, this guy's definitely the guy to beat.
He is amazing.
Did you watch the 60 Minutes piece on Sean White?
No.
They built him his own halfpipe, Red Bull, in the mountains of Colorado, where he has to get to by helicopter. Trains on his own, so no other competitors could see what he's going to be doing for the Olympics.
Interesting.
Wow.
Yeah.
Well, guys, switching sports now. The NBA All-Star Game takes place in Dallas this Sunday, so it's a perfect time for us to take a look back at the first halves of the Knicks and Nets seasons and look ahead at some second-half storylines in the association. Let's start with the Knicks. Steve, what stood out for you so far?
Well, you know, Nisa, they showed some signs and a pulse of actually getting to be a better team. They were battling for the eighth spot toward the end of the year, but the main thing they have to be a lot more consistent if they have any chance. In the first half, that was a big problem. The second half, the consistency definitely needs to be there. There is development and growth. You can see it with Chandler and Gallinari, but they've got to get their act together consistently. And defensively, they really must improve.
Yeah.
You know, guys, and interact with me on this one. Is there any excuse for this Market One New York City franchise to be this bad?
No.
Not at all.
I mean, you could right now, you could put Patrick Ewing, Charles Oakley, John Starks in uniforms, and they wouldn't have a worse record than the Knicks do right now.
You may
I think
be
it's
right.
The curse of old Penn Station of destroying that great architectural monument and building one of the worst monstrosities this city has ever experienced. What they got to do is forget about the playoffs if they want to get better and just focus on developing their young talent.
And, you know, the young guy who actually has stood out for me, and he's been the highlight of their first half, is David Lee. He's averaging a double-double, 20 points and 11 rebounds. He was named to the East All-Star team this week to replace the injured Allen Iverson, who didn't deserve to be there in the first place. Here's the thing with them for the second half. They basically have to forget about all the LeBron stuff and just play ball. Because chances are they're not getting him, Bosch, Wade, or any of those A-listers. Because it seems like Mike D'Antoni wants to go after Steve Nash and Joe Johnson.
Joe Johnson,
both of
yeah.
whom played for him in Phoenix and yeah. are both free agents after this year. The thing that will probably jump in front of the Knicks playing is going to be the impending Tracy McGrady trade, which is being
true.
Bandied about, where the you know he would come to the Knicks. Caron Butler and Haywood would go to Houston from Washington, and Al Harrington and possibly someone of the combination of Hughes, Curry, Jeffries, or somebody else will go to the Wizards in order to make the salary cap issues work. So Al Harrington knows about this, and
wow.
if it doesn't go off, there's going to be some drama in that locker room in the
oh,
second
man.
Half.
I bet there will be.
Well, moving across the river to the Nets, Jay, are there any positives to be found here?
No, absolutely not. All right, look, Brooke Lopez is actually coming into his own. He's averaging practically 19-9. Devin Harris has been all right, averaging 16 points and 6 assists. But this is still a team that is 4-48, the exact same mark at the 52-game season, at the 52-game mark that the 72-73 Sixers were at, and they finished with the NBA's worst record, 9-72. Here we go. The Nets, 30th in field goal percentage, 29th in three-point percentage, 28th in rebounding, 28th in assists, 30th in points per game. You want to know the only stat they're in the top 10 in the NBA in?
What?
At least positive stat. Free throw percentage, they're 6th.
My God. And they don't get there.
And they don't get to the line, which probably explains why.
Exactly. And I think for me, the question is, can it really get any worse? I guess it could. And then the other thing you have to ask is, are they at least going to win 10 games this year? I mean,
that's a good question.
I will tell you more in my three-minute warning about them, but I'll say Brooke Lopez is probably the one bright spot. There are a couple of other guys who are reasonably good, but their bench, there's nothing there to look at. And the fans could care less. I mean, that's another story in itself.
What did you say, Sean?
So few of my predictions over the last year have been on the money. But I did say that the Nets really weren't worth following, that you could just skip this story, go right to the next one, save your money, save your time, watch the Jersey Shore, watch the basically watch anything but the Nets. However, if you love lovable losers, maybe this is your team. I mean, their percentage is over 100.
Barely.
Under 100%.
Yeah, barely.
That's terrible. I think it would be more interesting if you're a sports fan to watch the Atlantic Yards Development Project rather than the Nets.
Or the D-League, perhaps.
I'd rather watch Frank
or
Gehry.
Paint drying.
Yeah. There you go.
I would really rather watch Frank Gehry come up with his master plans for the new structure in downtown Brooklyn than watch this team.
Okay, guys. Well, give me some second half players, teams, and storylines to watch for in the NBA. Sean, lead off.
You know, I just wish the Knicks would take some notes from that franchise in Los Angeles who is doing so well.
You're not talking about the Clippers, are
no,
you?
No, I don't think
Do they still have a team?
Just barely.
On paper, anyway.
Yeah, on paper.
What more can you say about the Lakers? They're consistent, they're stable, they're filled with star power, they're going to be there at the end of the year. It's no wonder Spike Lee is packed up his, you know,
uh-oh.
Knicks caravan went out there and is making movies on Kobe and not anybody on the Knicks
know,
franchise.
They got to stay healthy, Sean. Kobe missed the last game. He's skipping the All-Star game because of that ankle injury.
How many straight games
Odom
did he have?
Is a little banged up. Yeah. So is Gasol, Artes. So if they stay healthy, yeah, I agree with you. They'll be there
yeah,
at the end.
Yeah, they're the team. Well, for me, the team you got to look at is the Portland Trail Blazers.
Mm.
I mean, how does a team that's lost both their centers, we're talking about Odom and Prisbilla, and then they have Juwan Howard playing center, how is it that this team is somehow winning games? And then you look at their guards. These are two veteran guards. You're looking at Blake and Andre Miller. Their bench is unbelievable. I mean, guys like Bayless and Pendergraft coming off the bench. And somehow Nate McMillan gets this team to play great defense. That's how you do it. I think they're second in the league in defense, if the last time I checked. And that's really amazing considering all the injuries they have. So
it helps if you got LaMarcus Aldridge and Brandon Roy to
well,
rely on
yeah,
when they're healthy.
But yeah, even
when
Brandon
healthy.
Roy is hurt right now. That's another thing with the ankle problem.
You know, the Blazers used to be the NBA's next up-and-coming team. The team I'm going to be watching is the next up-and-coming team,
okay.
and that's Kevin Durant and the Oklahoma City Thunder.
Mm.
You know, Oak
yeah.
City is that's 30 good. And 21.
Yes.
That's there. Right now, they're the fifth seed out west. Mm. They have a winning record both home and on the road. They have a positive point differential. Kevin Durant is just all world. Almost 30 points, 7-plus boards, 1-plus steals. He leads them in all of those categories. He's the second youngest player in the NBA history to reach 5,000 points. You guys know who the first was. LeBron.
Yep.
He's had 23 straight games of 25-plus points or more. And you know what? He's got a hell of a running mate. Young Mr. Westbrook
yes.
is rounding nicely
oh, yeah.
into a solid NBA point guard. 16 points, 7.5 assists, and a very nice 2.34 assist to turnover ratio. Oak City's going to be a team to watch out for.
Absolutely.
Well, to me, the Cavaliers are still the team to beat.
Oh, yeah, of course.
Come on. They're miles apart from anyone else in the East. LeBron's on fire. He just won Eastern Conference Player of the Month for the third straight month in January. Gosh. He'll probably win MVP again this year. Uh-huh. I mean, if they don't win the championship this year, I don't even know what to do. Like, what else can they do?
And honestly, this is their best chance yet.
Both Orlando and
Boston are not as good as they were last year. And, you know, as good as the Hawks are, I still say Cleveland's better than them.
Yeah, I think so.
So it really is do or die time for them. Mm-hmm. Well, guys, last Sunday, the NFL played its Super Bowl. This Sunday, NASCAR has its own version of the big game with the 52nd running of the Daytona 500. Steve, who's the driver to watch?
You know what? It's about time it's Mark Martin.
Yeah.
Everybody else will tell you about Jimmy Johnson. They will tell you about Gordon. They will mention all the other great names, and they all need to be mentioned. But Mark Martin, he's kind of like the bridesmaid. He's always number two. He's the consistent driver. He's the oldest driver. And for the first time, he's on the pole. He's first on the pole. And that's why he has a chance of winning finally.
Well, you mentioned him. This guy even got his own HBO series. For the first time, 24/7, they got out of the boxing realm. They said, hey, let's try NASCAR. And it really brought you into what it's like to work on a pit crew, which was probably the most fascinating part about learning about Jimmy Johnson and his chances at Daytona. It's the build-up to this. Got really great reviews. I don't know if it broke barriers because the big ratings were in NASCAR havens like Alabama, North Carolina. HBO already conceded that. But I'll be watching Jimmy Johnson. What has he got? Four straight Spring Cups?
Four straight camp championships. He's going for number five.
My gosh.
And you know what, guys? All valid. Plenty of good drivers. Little E looks like he might actually be snapping out of his funk. Carl Edwards. Mm-hmm. Can't forget about Tony Stewart.
No.
But Danica Patrick kind of stole the boys' thunder this past week. Racing in stock car for her first time at the ARCA, which is NASCAR's minor league. She finished sixth. After, you know, qualifying. So she's planning on running at the Nationwide race, which is done Saturday, which is NASCAR's Triple A. And she actually, the fact that she even raced in this ARCA race, TV ratings jumped for that race 59%. Mm. Danica just has star power. All
right.
She has to do is basically show up.
Yep, that's
so
true.
And you know what? The guy who owns her car has probably got to be loving this, and that's Dale Earnhardt Jr.
Wow.
Because obviously he's not been making, you know, headlines for winning.
No.
So here's the thing, guys. Danica Patrick, she's going to make some noise in stock car. I believe that.
We'll see. Well, that music means it's time for the 3-Minute Warning. Jay, lead off.
Thanks, Nisa. Lindsey Vonn, Evan Lysacek, Apollo Antonono, Sean White, Stephen Holcomb. Wait, what? Who? Stephen Holcomb? No, this isn't a Winter Olympic case of which one of these is not like the others. Stephen Holcomb is a member of the U.S. Olympic team, but don't worry if you don't recognize the name. After all, bobsledding isn't as glamorous an event as figure skating, nor is it as exciting as speed skating or downhill skiing, or as cool as snowboarding. Stephen Holcomb is the driver for USA's four-man bobsled, and his story will make you want to watch his event and root for him and the team. Holcomb suffers from a degenerative eye disease that was thought to be incurable. He originally thought his vision was just going bad, but neither Lasix nor contacts seemed to work. It got to the point that he was close to going blind. He'd resigned himself to retiring from the sport that he loved. His coach had other ideas. They found a surgeon who on March 6, 2008, performed a procedure in an attempt to reverse the disease's effects. 360 days later, with Stephen at the controls, the U.S. won the four-man world championship. If he can pilot the USA's number one sled to a medal, it will end a drought of 62 years for the U.S. in four-man bobsled. It'll be quite a sight, one that not long ago, Stephen Holcomb never thought he'd see.
Newark is the right spot for the Nets. After years at the Izod Center, that drab mausoleum, the New Jersey Nets are leaving an arena where few came to see him. Even when they had players like Martin, Jefferson, Kidd, and Carter, apathy always reigned with their fans, leading to this sad departure. Except for Lopez, Harris, Lee, and CDR, the cupboard's been stripped bare. Rod Thorne ripped this team apart. Is it any reason that very few care? Poor trades, subpar role players, and failed draft picks? No, this time I'm not talking about the Knicks. These are the Nets, looking to invade Brooklyn and fighting eminent domain. Listen, it's time to wise up and get on the right train. That's out to Newark and the Prudential Center, which is where you should stay. Just imagine, now you can have a real fan base, new talent, and learn how to play. Spend some money for quality-free agents this time, and maybe then this sorry franchise will have some reason or rhyme.
NBC, they're forecasting a multi-million dollar loss through broadcasting the Winter Olympic Games. but they're still one of my favorite events. I got my turtle fur, I got my snow boots, I'm ready to go. Maybe it's because I'm such a fan of the bazaar. But really, where else can you see guys sweeping ice and picking up medals that are just as valuable as any other? Where else can you see guys huffing and puffing cross-country skiing and then taking aim and exercising their Second Amendment rights? And it has my favorite memory in all of sports, 2002, Salt Lake City, Apollo Anton Ono racing for the short track 1,000-meter gold medal. What happens? The four first competitors, they crash into each other. The oldest, slowest competitor, Stephen Bradbury, he comes from way behind, goes past all the down competitors, and wins the gold. The greatest moment in sports.
Enough of this nonsense about Peyton Manning's legacy being tarnished because he lost the Super Bowl. Let's get some perspective here, people. It's one game. Granted, a really big one, but it doesn't diminish his impressive NFL career. This is the man who's won four league MVP trophies, more than any other player in the history of the NFL. He started every game in his 12-year career. He led the Colts to at least 10 regular season victories in 10 of those 12 seasons. And he'll probably retire with every passing record in the book. Look, you can't lay blame for the Super Bowl loss solely on Manning. The Saints' Tracy Porter made a great play on the ball for that pick six that sealed the game. The Colts' defense fell apart in the second half. And Coach Jim Caldwell's too conservative play calling was a stark contrast to Sean Payton's aggressive play calling. Is Dan Marino's legacy tarnished because he never won a Super Bowl? No, he's still remembered as one of the greatest QBs of all time. Meanwhile, Peyton Manning is breaking all his records, and oh, by the way, he did actually win the Super Bowl a few years ago. And he could very well win another championship before his career is over. So can we please stop overreacting here, people? For Jay Kaplan, Steve Ferguson, and Sean Roman, I'm Nisa Cerulnik. Thanks for spending part of your evening with us. We'll see you on February 25th for another edition of On the Sports Lines. And remember, if you want to see this show again or catch up on any of the ones you might have missed, check us out at youtube.com/onthesportslines and check out our blog at onthesportslines.blogspot.com. Good night, everyone.
Night, everybody.
Night, everyone.